Hello, I'm Krista, and I'm the host of the Unstoppable Female Entrepreneur online show. Thank you for joining us again for another amazing episode with Connie Inukai. She is what you call a grandmapreneur, serial entrepreneur, and award-winning inventor, author of How I Got My Product on QVC, The Today Show, The View, and More in Retirement. She's also the creator of Write Your Selfie. So welcome with me today, Connie Inukai. How are you doing?
Thank you very much, Chris. It's so wonderful to be here with you virtually. So,
yes, it's wonderful to be with you too. So share with me how you've reinvented yourself in all the stages of your life. You've lived a very diverse path and had many roles and many ways of being in the world. So share with me your story.
Okay, so I was a college writing professor for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved it, but I actually did that so I could work my schedule around my children. Mm-hmm. Because I was a single mom, and so I got to choose courses when I could, you know. So I did that, and I loved that venue. Teaching college seniors how to write reports. So actually right around the time I turned 68 years old, I got an idea for an invention. Wow. Because my kids were grown. They were out of the house, and I was always helping college students find their dreams.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided, my goodness, I think I have to start inspiring myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually retired at age 68 from teaching at the University of Maryland and Johns Hopkins University. I taught both places because I was a single mom and I needed the money. And I started thinking a lot, and I made an invention. I created an invention, and I had absolutely no idea how to invent anything. And that's much like what I've been doing since my retirement, is learning things that I don't know. Like, I don't know technology very well, but I'm learning the best I can. And so yeah. I became an inventor. You're curious about my invention?
Yes, of course.
Okay, good. So this is my invention. Can you see this?
Yes.
Okay, this is called Tip and Split. And as I got older, I had a really hard time going out to eat with my friends, because none of us could see the menu or the bill because the print was too small and the restaurant was so too dark. So I made this invention, which has a magnifier, so I could read what's on the menu instead of just asking the server what's good. And then I put a little light on it. Can you see that?
Yep.
So so that we can see, because I used to have to go look around for a candle to read what was on there. So I also added a few features on it so you can figure out a tip and split the bill in 3 seconds. So that was my invention.
So you get to share more about that, because it does some fancy calculating, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. So what happened was, since I was teaching technical writing to engineers,
mm-hmm.
And I always gave them assignments about writing. Like, I asked them to make an instruction manual for their field, whatever, they had to look up something and write an instruction manual. So while I was teaching them and grading their papers, I actually made an instruction manual for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And then I taught them, it was all kinds of writing. Then I taught them, why don't you make a brochure for your company? Because mm-hmm. they had to sort of invent a new company. And so they made a brochure. So I made a brochure for my company. And all the while I'm teaching, I was getting antsy because I wanted to focus on my own stuff. And I felt like I had given them so much,
mm-hmm.
and I wanted to retire. So I learned how to invent from mm-hmm. nothing.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I was very lucky about is that I was actually divorced from an engineer and mathematician, and he's brilliant. And he actually, actually wrote all the algorithms for this to make it run smoothly. So, so that's how I got the name Inukai, because mm-hmm. that's actually a Japanese name, and I'm not real Japanese, although I like sushi. So I kept my name because I want to be associated with my children forever.
Yeah.
And they're Inukais. Yeah.
And you know, I think it's amazing that you are a visionary and that you see all possibilities and that you're resilient and you don't buy into the barriers of, you know, living in a technology driven world with
right
hoops to hop through and things to many barriers, and you don't perceive them as barriers that are going to stop you.
Right. I think that's a really good point, because if there's a barrier, I somehow have to figure it out, or I call my kids to help me out with it. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I've got lots of barriers, but I don't really worry too much about them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's very interesting. So I actually invented Tip and Split, and I actually don't let things hold me back, because I had a problem with a manufacturer who couldn't deliver my product. And I went to a trade show for inventors, and I didn't have my product. So I just had pictures of what it was going to look like. Mm-hmm. And actually, I pitched my product to QVC at the show, but with just pictures. Mm-hmm. And they said, wow, that sounds really great. Why don't you come back when you have the product? So I went back the next year. And I said, do you remember? I pitched again. And they said, do you remember me? And they all said, yes. And they said, well, I'm back here with my product. So can I show it to you? And they loved it. And they all applauded. And they put me on QVC.
Wow.
So that was absolutely amazing.
I have full body goosebumps right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I think it's amazing because you were the one who believed in yourself and this vision that you had, because they said that because they believed in you, but you also proved with your actions and your belief, your vision and your mission that you were going to create that.
Right. You know? Because it's a very good gift to give to older people instead of just a bathrobe and bedroom slippers, because we are more vibrant than that. We like to go out to eat. We just can't help it if the older we get, the smaller the print gets, you know? So I had a really good time. And then I got on a bunch of other shows, like the Today Show and The View. I got on those, and I was so excited. And then I actually put it on hold for a while because I had another problem with my manufacturer. So I put it on hold for a while, but I just found out some incredible news that I think I'm going to be on Home Shopping Network for Christmas.
Wow.
I think they want me on it, which is really nice. So anyway, so I think that's one way that I relate to you, because we are both unstoppable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are committed relentlessly to executing, creating, you know, not allowing things, barriers to stop us.
Right. So after I made my invention, because I taught writing and I'm a good writer, I wrote a book about it to help other inventors, because mm-hmm. everybody wanted to know how I got that amazing publicity. Mm-hmm. So that's when I wrote my book. Mm-hmm. Did you say, you said the name of my book, right?
Yes.
Okay, well, this is my book.
How I Got My Product on QVC, The Today Show, The View, and More in Retirement.
In retirement, yeah, amazing, in retirement. I'm 72 years old, and I'm still going strong. Mm-hmm. And I'm always reinventing myself.
So how has the path of, you know, you haven't always been an entrepreneur, right?
Never. Well, except the fact is, I think I always had it in my blood. But because I was raising three children as a single mother, I focused on my children. Mm-hmm. So, for example, my oldest son, Matt, he became a magician at age 6. And the reason he was is because I really didn't have any money. And his younger brother, who was turning 4, needed a birthday party, and I couldn't afford a magician. So I went to Toys R Us, and I bought him a magic kit. We worked on it for a few weeks, and he became a magician. Mm-hmm. And he did his brother Danny's show, birthday party first, and then he got booked every single weekend.
Wow.
For about maybe 6 till about 13. Mm-hmm. He was doing magic shows for every kid in the Washington, D.C. area. He had waiting lists, but we had to do it. I had to schedule him because I had 3 kids, and they also had soccer and baseball and basketball. So we would I would write down their schedules, and then we would book shows when we were able to do that. And Matt was even asked to do a magic show at the White House for Easter.
Did he get it?
Yeah. Wow. Somebody heard about him. They heard about him, and he did that. So then, see, I guess he was also a serial entrepreneur, but he was only 13. And then I tried to, since I was a single mom, I tried to be a little bit like a dad. So I used to take the kids to baseball card shows. And I, because we did that when I was young, and I thought there was a boy thing. So I took them, and Matt wanted to have a table at one. Mm-hmm. And he says, Mom, I can't compete with all these old people with their baseball card shows. So Matt started hosting baseball card shows for kids,
mm-hmm.
ages 6 till 16. And he would sell them a table for $10, and he rented out the Marriott Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And he would have kids from all over selling, buying a table and selling their cards. So I guess I was not an entrepreneur, but I was sort of
surrounded by it.
Yeah, helping him. Yeah, so then, you know, now I'm doing it for me.
Well, another thing with entrepreneurship is it's being a mom is like being an entrepreneur.
Exactly.
I think I've heard the root of the word entrepreneur, it means to try. I mean, when you're a mom, you're trying things, you're reinventing things, that didn't work, you're trying again, it's relentless, you're committed.
Right.
And so many of the core qualities of, you know, being a mom can transfer if you're committed to being an entrepreneur.
Right, exactly. And
I think in today's day and age, being a creator, I mean, we are all created to be co-creators and create and bring our genius, bring our mission to the world, and maybe multiple missions. I can attest to, you know, one of my missions is I love to be an employer. I love to give people job opportunities. I love to, within that, help them have growth, help them advance, and to make more, you know, make more money, to be a greater contribution in the world. And I think that ties into what you're sharing with the audience is about, you saw a gap, you saw something that was needed and that hadn't been created before, and you got inventive and
right.
came up with a solution. And the thing is the women on this, the female entrepreneurs, aspiring people, they're watching this show and they're wondering, how do I go from this vision, this itch in my soul, in my heart, to getting out there? And so what tips, what daily, tangible, relatable tips could you give the audience that about like the first steps, like what actions?
That is very good. I think that I sort of have a childlike personality. Like usually children have no boundaries. They can think about things and they can't really do it because they don't have money and they don't have the skills to do it. But I think that I'm so lucky because I still have that wonder in me, because I think that wonder and passion do not have an expiration date. And I think that I'm very lucky because I'm old and doing it. I don't have the responsibilities that you have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I applaud you. But what should somebody do? Well, actually, I joined Facebook groups where I could be surrounded by like-minded people. Mm-hmm. So I'm in two inventors Facebook groups.
Mm-hmm.
And I got inspired by them. And they're Facebook groups for women entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. So I joined those. And I listen to what they're saying. So I would say that's a very, very good way to start.
Mm-hmm.
To get involved, you know, I mean, we're so lucky we have Facebook. Mm-hmm. I wasn't really even on Facebook so much when I became an inventor. But then I joined a Shark Tank group,
Wow.
You know, of people who had been on Shark Tank because I wanted to be on Shark Tank. Mm-hmm. I didn't get on it. I got to the final round, but I didn't get on it. But I think that's really good. But, you know, let me just show you what I have in my office that I look at every day. Let me know if you can see this.
What if I fail? Oh, but my darling, what if you fly?
Yeah, uh-huh. So I think that's what I live by. Why be afraid? You know, you're never gonna get anywhere if you don't try.
Yeah.
If you don't try. So
I'm finding a seed commonality with a lot of these wonderful people that I'm interviewing and speaking with is it almost seems like a mistake sometimes, you know, like, you know, you have an idea and you think maybe, oh, it's small, or you minimize it. You're like, oh, if I could create a calculator, that would be sure be nice. And then it just starts to culminate. And then, you know, you had someone that was like, wow, like QVC, they were like, wow, this could go somewhere. Mm-hmm. And then that edifies you and you go, wow, I get to do this. And some things just happen by mistake. Maybe you'll meet this person and mm-hmm. you don't know where the road leads. You've never been down it before.
Right, right.
And that's curiosity. You're going back to that childlike trust. You're in the present moment, Connie. You're creating from like a child, when you tell them that we have to be somewhere at 11:30, they don't get the concept of the next step. The curiosity comes from having no attachment to necessarily the next thing. Like it's not like us adults, we get in our heads and we get sticky and we're like, we try to conceptualize things. And I'm just really emphasizing the key points to the audience to help them understand like the beauty of who you are and what you embody to create what you create, you know?
Exactly. Exactly. You put it so well. Like my mind, I think that like I'm an inventor. I have about 5 more inventions in my head and each one of them is in a little bag where I have little props that I put it together. Mm-hmm. But I really don't have the time to focus on more than one invention at a time.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I'll start on it right after this Zoom conference. I think I'll start on my next invention. I have so many ideas mm-hmm. that have nothing to do with my tip and split.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you want to work on one with me. It's for people who have young teens.
Mm-hmm.
That's too old for you. But anyway, I have so many ideas.
Before I know it.
Uh-huh. I have so many ideas. And all you have to do is like figure out where to go. So you ask, where do you find out? Well, I think Facebook groups are the best. And I also joined at my age SCORE, which mm-hmm. is, have you heard of it? It's for old retirees who help people start a business.
I've heard of SCORE. But in a sense of like something put on by the Washington State business.
Yeah, every state has a SCORE team and it's of retired people who want to help, usually younger ones.
Yeah.
I think I'm older than my SCORE mentor, but he just encourages me all the time. So I joined that mm-hmm. and he just, you know, just he feels my passion. And he's always giving me ideas, what to do next.
Yeah.
So I would encourage people who have a little inkling of an idea to join SCORE. It's free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 I know my mom's talked to me about it before.
Uh-huh.
I've always, you know, I was blessed, just another happenstance thing. I was blessed to run into Jerry Petrick, who is works for the WSBC, which is a Washington State Business Center. And he, it's like, I look back on my story and in the moment, you don't know you're being blessed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like right. This interview, this online show could be our listeners' first like touch to, or the second or third or fourth.
Right.
And they don't know what, like you have knowledge and power and skills and mindset that is so powerful. Like I have been down the path of entrepreneurship for 9 years and our mission, our story could speak powerfully to someone else.
So you've been on it longer than I have. I'm sort of in a rush because of my age. And like now I have no children to raise.
Mm-hmm.
Although I have 2 young children who live with me. But my mind is always going. And when my next venture came about because of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's so depressed or, you know, stir crazy or what. And in March, when COVID started, you know, getting
intense,
prevalent, yeah, intense, I decided, let me be positive about it.
Mm-hmm.
So because of my age, I'm a high-risk person, and I didn't want to go anyplace except to the grocery store. And those were quick trips. And so what I did is I gathered all of my photo albums mm-hmm. and 2 boxes filled with pictures. Now, you probably can't relate to that because you grew up
on
iPhone. Oh, you can?
It was my job to organize all the photos.
So I organized all the photos, and I decided to write a book of my life, but based on photos. Because some people write their memoir when they get to be older to pass down, but nobody wants to read like 1,000 pages of your memoir. So the book that I wrote is almost all pictures and captions. And so you could read it like in about less than an hour.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could read it like some of it in 10 minutes. So I did that. It started in March and then I wrote my book.
Mm-hmm.
And my next, it's like so exciting because I have, you can't really see
it. I didn't see it.
Uh-huh. But one of my favorite stories I found out when I did research, I didn't even know this when my parents were alive, and that is my mother's parents immigrated to the U.S. from Poland in 1912, and they had to cancel their trip because she had morning sickness.
Mm.
And the trip that they canceled was the Titanic. So I found that out after my mother died.
Giving me goosebumps again. Oh my gosh. I'm like getting like
So isn't that an interesting story to pass down to my children and my grandchildren? Nobody knew about that. I found out from a cousin, you know, of mine. I didn't know it. So, because I would have asked her about it. So my parents are gone. So I decided to write my book so that my children will know all about me.
Mm-hmm.
And then my next adventure or project is I'm learning about how to write an online course, and I'm going to help other people write mm-hmm. their book
mm-hmm.
in like less than a month. Mm-hmm. How to go through pictures, pick them, choose captions, and then how to place them, and you know how to make their book
mm-hmm.
so they can give it to their family like, for a present. Because what better mm-hmm. gift can you give? So that was my next project. So it's got nothing to do with my invention.
Yeah.
It's just got to do with my mindset.
Yeah, and I think it's the story. I think it's so powerful for us all to remember just the power of storytelling, the power of connecting the dots for people.
Right.
You know, like what influenced Connie? What why did she create what she created in her life? And what was her child like? I mean, our childhood, I said that wrong. Our childhood is such an integral part of it's a kickoff show of our life. And it seeds so many paramount moments that shape our subconscious mind that then go into creating the patterns and the realities and our perceptions of the world. And that's why you see such a wide diversity, because we're all in different, I mean, it's like you can raise two children in the same home and have them turn out completely differently.
Exactly. So when you just reminded me of something that I kind of forgot about. Mm-hmm. But when you talked about childhood, when I was 16, mm-hmm. I had a boyfriend who died in a car crash. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I was actually visiting my grandma at the time, so I heard about it, you know, and I rushed home. And he was brilliant, and he was 16 and already accepted to Yale, mm-hmm. and of course he couldn't go there. So at that moment, after crying for 3 months solid, mm-hmm. I decided I have to make something of my life, mm-hmm. for him and me. And to this day, I'm 72. And so he's been dead for a long time. But that was how I started my book, with a picture of Clayton, mm-hmm. you know, who died, because he's still in my mind. Isn't mm-hmm. that something? So we are influenced by our children. And it sort of makes me always want to do more, because mm-hmm. I know he would have.
Well, and I love that too, because you have this mission and desire to help the youth uh-huh. into their calling, because it's a big deal. It's a big deal finding out. I just remember the years, like 15, 16, 17, as I was approaching like the decision-making process of my life, uh-huh. I used to lay there in bed when I was 16 and go, oh, I know I only have 2 more years of this. Like being taken care of by my dad and having meals provided. I knew I was going to be independent. And I actually ended up moving out when I was 16 for just a couple months, live with my grandparents, which was an experience I'm actually really thankful for now. There's some things going on at home. I was thankful that I could just go there, and I have made memories with my grandpa, my grandma, that I'll never forget. So I'm grateful for that, even though it was because I was so annoyed and I was tired of living with my parents. I moved back in for a little bit and then moved back out. But it's just so powerful, the story of our childhood. And I know, like, I originally wanted to be a naturopathic doctor, and then my parents had spent my college fund on some credit card debt. And I was like, crap, what am I going to do? And so then that's what catapulted me into being an entrepreneur. So I had just a little bit in savings and I grew my business from that savings. But it's just so powerful for our viewers to remember their story is unique. Their story is valuable, and they don't get to look like anyone else besides themselves.
Right. Right, exactly. Like, we all have our own story to tell. So I think by listening to you, it mm-hmm. brings out things that I can relate to about me. Well, mm-hmm. I already wrote my book, but if I was going to do it again, I would add other things, you mm-hmm. know, but you have to call it, you know, stop at some point. But yeah, I think that we all have something to share. Mm-hmm. And I think the idea, you know, about, the question you asked me is, what advice would I give to somebody? Mm-hmm. Well, share what you are familiar with. Learn what you're not familiar with, but share what you're familiar with. Because I'm actually going back to my writing. Mm-hmm. Because I was a writing teacher for 40 plus years. Mm-hmm. And so now I wrote a book. It's not really writing. It's mostly collecting pictures. But it's something about writing. Mm-hmm. And I actually started teaching online courses way before they became popular. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad I have that, so I know how to do that. But, you know, think about something you like to do. Mm-hmm. You know, like, a lot of people like gardening. I don't really, you know, I like pulling out weeds every once in a while just for relaxation because I have to, but it's not something that I would want to do all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, entrepreneurship, that is so exciting.
Yeah.
If you can make money at it, it's great. But even if you can't, it's so fulfilling.
Yeah. Yeah. And what's that circle chart called where you have three circles that are touching each other in the middle?
Yeah. What's it called?
Okay, it's a special type of graph.
Yeah. I can't remember.
I'm thinking of that analogy of
a Venn diagram.
Yeah. Yeah. So the Venn diagram is in the center where all the circles touch, and the other circles are all the possibilities. And what you're articulating, I'm just kind of putting it into an image, is like, don't think you have to know the whole next circle.
Right.
Take what you know, and what makes you unique.
Right.
And know that when you overlap those circles in your life, like, okay, I have tip and split, and I learned how to invent, and I learned how to, you know, reach out and ask for support, and all these things that you've learned, you're learning how to take those, all the skills from being a parent, from being having your story from your childhood, and you're adding all those overlaps, and then you're creating another possibility in your life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like for me, I'm going into life coaching and business coaching and supporting women live their mission out in the world. And it's not like, okay, I don't know what I'm going to exactly create. I don't know what connections I'm going to make. I don't know what my revenue is going to be for the next year exactly. But I know that I'm taking what I've learned, I've taken the skills that I've had, I'm going to create something from that.
Yeah, and don't be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most entrepreneurs have to get rid of all their fear mm-hmm. and just go for it,
mm-hmm.
especially if it's not a huge investment.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, mine was kind of a huge investment because I had to get a number of products from, you know, like, mm-hmm. 5,000 tip and splits from China, you know, to sell.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of expensive, but I figured, okay, you know, I'll do it. If that's what I need, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So I think that, you know, another thing that people can do to learn about how to do it is coming on your show.
Mm-hmm.
Your conference is very good because you're going to have so many speakers that are going to them, and something is going to make sense or hit a nerve, and you mm-hmm. know, maybe they'll want to contact that person later mm-hmm. and figure out, you know, just do a little brainstorming and get like a buddy
mm-hmm.
you know, to get inspired by. So mm-hmm. I think that's a wonderful thing for everybody who signs up for this presentation. They've taken already the best step they could.
Yeah. Yeah, and thank you for that. So you have a free gift to share with our audience, a free book. Can you share?
Yes. Yes. It's the book that I showed you. Even if they're not an inventor, well, now I don't know where I put
how it. I got my product on QVC, the Today
yeah.
Show, you and more.
I'm gonna send them this. If they want it, they can just sign up. I have to figure out how to send it to them. Because I have to figure that out, but they can get this because this book has tips about getting publicity,
mm-hmm.
but it's not only about publicity because it's also about entrepreneurship. And mm-hmm. I talk about this, how many tips do I have? I have, 8 tips.
Mm-hmm.
And the first one is to always be, positive and surround yourself with positive people.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody who's going to be an entrepreneur, and you ought to know that, Krista, there are always people are going to say, why are you doing this?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
But then there's people that aren't saying that.
Right. You have to pick those people to talk to. The mm-hmm. other people, you can say, hi, you know, but I wouldn't tell them what I'm doing because they don't really get it. They always try to discourage. So I have lots of tips that are actually... life tips also. Oh, I think we're going to show you my granddaughter.
We get a real life moment.
Yeah.
Cutie.
This is life. This is Victoria. She helps me all the time. Okay, can you say hi to Krista? Take that out of your mouth. Okay. Okay, now you have to go away, okay? I'll see you later, okay?
Grandmapreneur, there you go.
Yeah, and by the way, speaking of Grandmapreneur, because I was an inventor, I know the importance of names, because I have a patent on my tip and split, and I trademarked the name, and I also trademarked Grandmapreneur,
mm-hmm.
And I also trademarked Write Your Selfie,
because
mm-hmm. I thought that's a very good name for people, because it's not like a selfie that you take your picture, but it's a mm-hmm. selfie that you take your life,
mm-hmm.
you know, pictures of your life.
Yeah, beautiful.
So, yeah, so, yeah, I trademarked it by myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I just looked it up, how to do it, and I did it.
Wow.
So anyways. Yeah.
That's amazing to trademark something. I've never even, like, that's a realm of, like, something I've never had to think about. And that's why the power of community is, like, if I needed to trademark something, hey, Connie, can you guide
me? Yeah, you can contact me. Because after I got a trademark, I got at least 20 emails from lawyers asking me if I would like help with my trademark. And they wanted to charge me anywhere from $200 to $800. To do it. And I said, no, thank you. And I did it myself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So anyway, so you can always find out things if you're not afraid.
Mm-hmm. Connie, you're so generous. I really appreciate you.
Thank you. Anyway, this has been so much fun talking with you. And I just think that you are an inspiration to all of us. And thank you for putting this together. Okay, and I can't wait to hear what I learned from your other guests.
Yeah, there's been some powerful interviews.
Uh-huh, okay, well, that's great. Well, I'm so happy to know you, and I can't wait to...